Hey, welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here. We're live from the SCC studios in White Bear Lake. And for Maplewood, it's your last live show coming from these studios for Speechless. And Maplewood is closing up shop for the very reason is they don't want free speech. And they want their speech and only their speech, even though you're paying for it. For to have a wide assortment of programs, a wide assortment of opinions, they want to shut it down, and so they're going to. We'll see how well that works for them, but more on that later. We're also seeing live right now in St. Paul over SPNN. Glad to have you here, and of course it replays many other places. Tonight's show, of course, is going to be a lot on Maplewood, the budget, cable, problems that they're having, arrogant people, the Human Rights Commission stuff, a little update on that, free speech issues, basically dealing with a lot of cities. But then we also have the St. Paul School Board we're going to be talking about, and of course, you know, I talk about the transgender inclusiveness policy that they have there, and went down and spoke to them again, and you know, they didn't like it, but that doesn't matter. You speak the truth and they're accountable. That's what you have to do. Now, for weeks I've said I'm going to be giving an update on the Sandra Grazzini-Ruckey case, where the missing children had been found and that she's being charged with hiding them from her father, and various other people have been charged with deprivation of parental rights. So I'm going to hopefully get to that. That's my goal. Who knows how much the Maplewood. I do want to focus on Maplewood a lot because, you know, this is it, you know. So let's start out with St. Paul School Board. Well, you know what? First of all, the paper here. You know, Ted Cruz is in town. We might have a clip coming in about Ted Cruz, but there was a protest down at the St. Paul City Council meeting, and the council voted to condemn the candidate's comments, Donald Trump. His comments and the First Amendment rights advocates are pushing back. Well, you know, the city council has a right to condemn a candidate's comments, and the candidate has the right to condemn the city council's comments. That's the give back and forth. The city council does not have the right, though, to stop Donald Trump from speaking or any other politician or individual from speaking. So it's, you know, it's just part of the back and forth game of the governmental process, not politics, the governmental process to try to get people to vote and to try to discourage other people from voting. Both sides are about suppressing votes, and they want to suppress the other side's vote, but they want to have their side have more people vote. So that's... But just the aspect of, you know, trying to tell people what they can and can't say, and you had that going on in Maplewood, where City Councilman Juniman was just all over the place going and saying how bad it is for the citizens of Maplewood who are senior citizens or those representing senior citizens to come to her and tell her their complaints, how terrible it was for them to do that. But if we go as a citizen, as a human being, to that Maplewood City Council and say, the council is behaving badly and Kathleen Juniman is behaving badly. Oh no, you're going to get gobbled down. You're going to get shut out. We have rules of civility, but they don't apply to the council. Well, they do apply to the council. They're just not going to do anything about it. That's why you're going to want to watch the Maplewood section, because big upcry. Well, and outcry that came in response to Kathleen Judeman's statements. Okay, let's watch the St. Paul School Board, my speak to them, and then we'll make comments afterwards. I really thought it was pretty good.
Superintendent isn't here today, okay. Couple comments here. The press conference with attorney, County Attorney Choi and Silva, they talked about this is the problem with violence is a community problem and not just a school problem, and I agree with that. But the responsibility of the board and the superintendent is to deal with the school problem. And I like the idea of a task force, but if you're going to just have like-minded people on the task force and doing the same things that the system has done over and over again, I don't think it's going to work. And so I think it'd really be good to put some people on that task force who have some differing opinions. They may be outvoted, but at least some debate and dialogue going on. I'd put Bob Zick on that task force. He's an expert on a lot of things. And a very insightful person. And then I put the task force on cable TV. And also the meeting you have before this meeting. Those things should be open and transparent. I think, and so the public can be able to see them. I think part of the problem is because of a policy that was been established. And there's an article that came out on a individual, a man in his 40s or 50s, Stephanie Walsh, Canadian man, who says he's a woman in a woman trapped in a man's body, but is really 6 years old. And there's an article, and I'll leave the article here, about first things. And this Carl Truman makes this statement. So when it comes to transgender people mewing and puking about how Walsh is trivializing their cause, let me put it this as simply and gently as I can. When you decide that categories of identity are merely psychological and that reality is construed by language, you consequently have neither the right nor the ability to call a halt to the Promethean process which you have unleashed just because some of the results prove to be distasteful to you and unhelpful to your political cause. Indeed, whining like a bunch of 6-year-old girls is not going to help you at this point. And the article goes further. The point here is when feelings our objective truth, fact no longer has reasoning, and therefore you can't have discipline in your schools. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kenley.
Who do I leave this with? Someone on the record?
All right.
Yeah, that was fun. You know, dealing with the issue of violence, and, you know, Bob Zick was down there 2 years ago saying we got a problem with this discipline, especially of the students towards the teachers. And of course the school board was down there abusing teachers themselves in the way they treated the teachers. So you kind of go, all right, why shouldn't the students abuse the teachers? And so you have this pattern going on. And being able to recognize it is one thing, and the St. Paul School Board refused to recognize it, and the administration refused to recognize it and did nothing until the press got a hold of it and it became too big to ignore. And so then what happens is the school board feigns, oh, we got a problem, we're going to solve it. Of course, they're the ones that created it. And so in their solving of the problem, they go out and have a task force. But with this task force, who do they put on the task force? Well, I don't know who they put on, but here's what happens. The same people who caused the problem. So they're not going to be able to come up with solutions. to the violence problem against teachers. And of course, you're always going to have some form of violence because human nature is in there. But understand, the school board does not recognize human nature. By my talking about human nature, I'm talking about just the depravity of man itself. Man by itself, starting out in the depraved, needs to be redeemed. Okay, and unless that redemption happens, that depravity is going to continue. And so people will make bad decisions. Even if you're redeemed, you're going to make bad decisions. You're a human. And it's human nature to do that, but you still have to hold people accountable in that process. And that's what the school board isn't doing. And so having somebody who can articulate the problem on this task force, having somebody who can articulate a solution is very important. So put somebody on that task force that you don't like. So put Bob Zick on that task force. I'll go on that task force, you know, but are they going to do that? No. So it goes to a bigger problem here, and that's what I was trying to address. The bigger problem is not just the violence, it's what creates the violence. And what I was talking about is when you have this philosophy that feelings are objective reality, what you feel is the truth, then you cannot do anything because a person is going to live based on their feelings, which to them is truth. So objective truth is thrown out the door, and then you can't have discipline. So with Superintendent Silva, who, by the way, was not there, I was looking where, you know, at the beginning, this audio kind of got cut out just till the very end. I was looking, where was she? She wasn't there to hear the public comments. She came for the board meeting, but I think she's getting a little gun shy of people questioning her. So I had found this article. Well, it came to me from a friend. There's a blog and if you Google First Things and Carl Truman, you'll find this article. You'll find the website that's there. And he raises a big issue. The transgender policy, inclusiveness policy, sets up a policy that whatever your feelings are, therefore that's what you are. And of course, in my prior statements, hey, if you're a male, every single cell in your body is male. If you're a female, every single cell is female. Okay, there isn't this mixture going on. All right, so the DNA will decide, but you feel like you're something else. So St. Paul School Board has already said your feelings as a six-year-old or five-year-old or however your age is objective fact. Therefore, if you feel that you are a boy when you're really a girl or vice versa, then that is objective fact and we will treat you that way because that's your feelings. Okay, so the school board thinks that that's where it ends. Okay, but it doesn't end that way. Now you got another depraved person out there not wanting to live in reality, who's a Canadian man, Stephanie Walsh, who has decided, and this is, I'm going to start reading from the article and make a few comments, has decided that he is not simply a woman trapped in a man's body, but actually a six-year-old girl trapped in the same. He's attracted some web attention. At first, I thought the story was a hoax, but no. It would appear that the lunatics have taken over the asylum, and it is indeed true. Even if a sick joke, however, it would still offer insight into the inner logic of politics of identity as currently played by the left. St. Paul School Board, I'm adding that in there. They have this politics of identity. Thus, for example, the UK's Pink News reports that parts of the trans community are upset. Not, of course, that at the harm done to Walsh's life, wife, and children. You know, who cares about his 5 or 7 kids that he has? Who cares about his wife and the tragedy that they have to live through and the embarrassment that they have to live through from the behavior of this man, whose symbol of burgess oppression, who are thus just so much collateral damage in the glorious revolution of the self, or the selfish. Of course, the guy's being selfish. No, they're upset because his claim to be a different age discredits their cause. Okay? So, if you can feel that you're a woman when you're a man, what? Why stop there? Why stop at the age you are? Why not say you're the age you think you are, age 6? Matter of fact, you know what? I'm 65. I'm going to go down to Social Security and start collecting retirement because that's what I believe. My feelings are right there. I'm 65. I'm going to get Social Security. Now, I'm not 65, okay? I'm younger than that, in case you didn't know. So you see what's going on here? So here's this guy who can then says, because I believe I'm 6, since I believe I'm a woman, why can't I believe I'm 6? Now I'm just going to go behave like I'm 6. And so the transgender community is upset because it discredits their cause. Well, you know what? It does discredit their cause. It shows the ridiculous nature of the transgender community to believe you're something you're not. Now, you can play act and you can pretend and you can, you know, the whole world knows you're not. You know, you know if you're a man, you're a man. The whole world knows that. But you can play and you can pretend, but you shouldn't get any special benefits because you act. You're play acting. Just as you shouldn't get benefits as if you're 6. Does he have the right now to go into grade school and first grade, start all over again and relive it? No, he never got past age 6. He's always been there. So he just keeps going to grade school. So let's go back to what Carl Truman has to say. A moment's reflection would indicate that this condition, whereby a person is really a small child incarcerated within a much older adult body, is increasingly prevalent in today's society. Recent events on the campus of some of America's top universities, clearly show that the transgist community is rapidly growing in size, influence, and belligerence. Still, as with all vanguard movements, some opposition is to be expected. The concerned reaction of sections of the transgender community is therefore understandable. Or is it really understandable? If everything else which shapes our identity can now be determined by mere personal preference, why single out age as an exception? After all, the way we measure time is a human invention. For example, we arbitrarily build our calendar around the Earth's orbit of the sun. It's arbitrary, you realize that. I have always thought that this is a somewhat imperialist imposition of heliocentrism on our lives. We also assume that time moves forward, one moment following another, but that too is really a linguistic construct. Time is a floating signifier, a patriarchal myth, to coin a term, the old-fashioned idea of linear chronology now represents a somewhat heterotemporal approach to existence, methinks. Okay. So, I mean, why do we do it with time? Why, you know, if we can pretend we're something else and that's reality, why not with time? It's the bottom line. It's course, I think there's some sarcasm here in what he's saying, but that's the reality of what they're doing. And it will extend to a lot other areas, and it already has. So when it comes to transgender people, and this is what I read to the school board, when it comes to transgender people mewling and puking about Walsh is trivializing their cause, let me put this as simply and gently as I can. When you decide that categories of identity are merely psychological and that reality is constituted by language, you consequently have neither the right nor the ability to call a halt to the Promethean process which you have unleashed just because some of the results prove to be distasteful to you and unhelpful to your political cause. Indeed, whining like a bunch of 6-year-old girls is not going to help you at this point. In other words, you started the process. You can't stop it. You have no right to whine about it. And basically, based on your standards, this man is a 6-year-old, and he gets to get treated like a 6-year-old. He gets to go back into first grade, and you know, and he can stay there as long as he feels like it. That's what the reality of what you've done. You do not believe. I will go back to Mr. Truman. You do not believe me? Then perhaps it is time to call the spirit of Nietzsche's madman once more from the grave. You who have so derided any notion of human nature and external authority. Okay, I talked about that at the school board. Just the denial of what human nature is about, that there is a depravity in man that, left unchecked, goes to this baseness, this vileness, this deception that Walsh has gone to. Do you now have the courage to face the world for whose birth you yourselves were the midwives? You who have unchained the sun from this earth, can you now live with the consequences of your own actions, where all things, even chronological age, must surely give way before the will to power? Face the reality you have made, where Mr. Walsh is the Nietzschean Übermensch, or to be precise, the Überkleins Machen of the New Order. Okay, he's the new standard that's coming up that you're going to have to deal with. Okay, well, that's enough on St. Paul's School Board. Go to First Things, Google First Things, and then Carl Truman, T-R-U-E-M-A-N. Read the rest of the article. Live in reality. Live in the truth. Otherwise, we're in a world of hurt. And that's what's playing out in St. Paul with the school board, with the administration, with discipline in the schools. They have no moral authority to have any discipline in that school, and their task force will come up with nothing because they won't be able to. They'll have to have some form of objective reality come into play, and they can't do that because feelings are the objective reality, and anybody can have any feeling they want. All right. Okay, let's get to Maplewood here. We're going to go to the DVD and number 2. Is that anywhere near being ready? Okay. Maplewood's going through their budget, of course, the cable stuff. They voted it to approve their 4% levy increase. That was part of the discussion. So I got up to talk about this, added a few more things because they keep asking you to do things that they're really not supposed to ask you to do. So it takes away from your time because Karen Haig, the city clerk, city communication person, she starts the clock. Matter of fact, when I got there, the clock was already running before I even got up there. because of the whatever reason. So when you have these meetings, you know, like at the legislature, you can go down and sign up ahead of time, or you can just show up and say you want to speak. They put you on a list, but usually at the end, and unless they forget, the chairman down at the legislature, they forget, they ask if anybody else has anything else to say from the public, to get public input. Well, this is the same thing here, and I know that, so I didn't sign up. I wanted to hear what everybody else had to say, and if I didn't have anything different or anything to add, I wasn't going to say anything. So I just waited to the end and then said, hey, I want to speak. And so that's where we start off with. So let's roll the DVD.
Check on the process to the parliamentarian. If you not signed up, how do we handle this?
Madam Mayor, members of the council, we ask that individuals that are requesting to speak to sign up. I mean, it's not something that it is, it's more of a, so that you can govern and know how many people that you're going to be having speak. In the event that we would have 30 people here, then you could kind of govern how we were going to let them speak.
I see.
For time's sake.
So I know that I do ask for three times, so I know you're permitted to speak. I just wanted to check with that. So if you could please state your name and your address for the record. Thank you.
Yeah, Tim Kinley, and address is not on the record, and we don't have to identify ourselves anymore by the human rights policy and the police policy that has now been established. So you're not going to get my address. And I'm not required to give it anyway. Following up on Mr. Berglund there, I think when you, and here's an example, and I've seen some other from some citizens in Maplewood, somebody has an estimated market value of $95,000, and it goes up to $115,000, a $20,000 increase in 1 year. And when the graph was shown that there was a number of these houses, I would ask the, I would take it on as representation, as the city council representing the citizens here, to go ahead and ask Ramsey County, what's the deal going on here? You know, there's no home improvements, no any of that going on. A 20, that's a huge, over a 20% increase in 1 year. That just does not make any sense, and the market values aren't going up here in Maplewood. So the attitude, the philosophy should be, wow, let's represent our people before Ramsey County and say, this seems to be a problem here, and let's go talk to them. And just a number of your rules of civility here are unconstitutional. And when you, in your speech, talk about other your employees of the city and stuff like that, we can too. So get used to it.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak?
All right. Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I think what Norris Lawick was trying to do, the mayor of Maplewood, was trying to pass it off to Karen Haig to give her an answer as why she didn't have to let me speak, because I didn't sign up, you know. But then the reality overcame where she realized she had to say three times, is there anybody else that wants to speak? Of course, why would you say, is there anybody else that wants to speak? And then somebody raises a hand and then you go, oh, no, you can't speak. Well, then why ask the question? You know, so she's been down at the legislature for, you know, years. She knows how it goes. So why even go through that exercise? So that's why, instead of talking about spending more time on the taxes, the property tax increases, the levy increase, I had to spend time on the address issue. Of course, that response, whether I get to speak, and of course the address issue, was because the Human Rights Commission voted to approve the police department's making Maplewood a sanctuary city. And so if they want to ask me what my address is, and I'm a citizen, but if it's an illegal alien or criminal alien, they don't have to ask them where they live. And it's just this weird, weird standard going on. And actually at the Human Rights Commission, the people that spoke who were promoting the sanctuary city and promoting hiding criminal illegal aliens in Maplewood, they never had to give their address. Didn't have to do it. So actually now, folks, when a police officer pulls you over, it's Maplewood, you don't have to give them your address. You know, how does this work? What are they doing here? You know, how's this, you know, why do non-citizens have more rights than the actual citizens? It's bizarre to say the least. So on the tax issue, and I went before the Maplewood City Council this year, because they were bringing up the levy issues, and properties had gone up in value throughout the year. Okay, but they're not now. But I saw, and there was a handout there, and it was similar to one that I had seen, where a person's home value went from $95,000 to $115,000. That's what Ramsey County said. What in the world? There's no change to this home. Why did they do that? Okay. It doesn't make sense. And so you have, and so there was a pattern going on of this is how you raise more revenue for the city. If property values go down, you have to increase your levy so that you can raise more tax dollars to meet your budget and to continue to have your budget grow. But then when property values go up, you're going to collect more revenue. And that's what had taken place. Not only did they increase the levy the prior years, they increase it again this year's with property value going up, so it becomes a bigger hit. So this person ended up with almost a 30% tax increase just for Maplewood. And of course, Maplewood says we don't have any control over that. Well, they have control over their levy amount and they have control over their budget. And they want to pass it off as to other issues. No, deal with your issue and what people are talking about before you. And they were saying because they're passing it off to other people, that's why I raised the point. Hey, it's a big enough issue here in Maplewood that people's value were artificially inflated to higher than they are, than they were. So therefore, you should be working on behalf of the people of Maplewood to minimize the increase in the value when you see this pattern going on, and should let them know, hey, Ramsey County kind of messed up. Let's get together. We'll help you go down to Ramsey County and get your property values evaluated to the right place, to where they should be. Now, of course, the problem for Maplewood, that means they make less money. So why would they do that? So it's not about you, the citizen. It's about the Maplewood employees who don't live in Maplewood trying to squeeze you for your dollar. Okay. let's go then to number 4 on the DVD. And I don't remember what I'm talking about, but it was another public comment time. So let's see what I have to say.
Tim Kinley, and I noticed the clock's already running there. A couple questions I have. I guess I would like to have some of the answers while I'm talking here, but how are the loans doing? And was the Larkin Dance the first one? Because I thought what I remembered, and since there isn't a sheet dealing with the loans and what we've already have given money to other people, was the hospital part of that? Was the retaining wall part of that? But either way, if it's only been Larkin Dance Studios, I don't think that fits the definition of this loan. And then also, we're not a church. We're not a charitable organization. You're coming threatening to take people's property away if they don't pay their taxes at the force of a gun. Okay? And so when you're taking money from other people and then giving it to other people that is not a government function, that's not your job, and you shouldn't be doing that. And actually, I'm a little surprised that the Maplewood Community Center hasn't come up as a recipient of the EDA fund because of its financial instabilities, never making money since its existence. I think personally, don't have a increase and just get rid of the fund altogether and let the charities take care of what the charities need to take care of. And you do things for the whole people, and Larkin Dance Studio isn't for everybody. Neither is the Maplewood Community Center. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah, that's the EDA, Economic Development Authority. And so they're doing a levy, half a percent levy, on your property to raise money and hand it out to the people who they want to hand it out to. It's just outrageous that this is happening. And that was my comment as to why they're not a church. You don't get to do that. You can do the roads, you can do police, you can do fire. It's something that everybody benefits from, but you can't do the community center, you can't do the EDA. They had a couple other loans out there to St. John's, but I don't know if that was part of the EDA. But they went out and did these $400,000 loans, built a retaining wall, did a whole bunch of stuff for private corporations, for private people, and borrowed them money. People that had the money could do it themselves. But they did it anyway. What's going on with that? That's not right. They shouldn't have done that. And, of course, there was no report as to how all these other loans have gone. You know, the whole goal of Maplewood and from their conversation was to hopefully that Larkin Studios doesn't have to pay back the loan if they meet their goals. That's just terrible. Now, why I'm talking or why I'm going up, you hear Kathleen Juneman or you hear Mayor Slawick, you hear them making comments, you know, while you're talking, and that's against the rules of civility. They are not to do that, but they do it anyway. And then they expect you to abide by different rules. You know, and Kathleen Juneman is a big, big problem. She thinks she gets special privileges and gets to do things that nobody else gets to do. And so if you can look on the DVD, and I'll tell you which one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The last one, number 8. Let's hear what Kevin Berglund has to say. And he's talking about the EDA. But unfortunately, because the council says things that they're not supposed to say, they're saying things, you have to counteract what they say. And the council was talking about civility, and therefore you need to counteract it, which takes away from your 3 minutes, rather than instead of talking about the issues. So let's hear what Kevin had to say.
Mayor, City Council, thank you. Hypocrisy of the rules. Welcome to the city of Maplewood. Ms. Hooper spoke of a problem that shows long-term management problems up at the city of Maplewood, managed by the city manager, Melinda Coleman. Can't even get the sidewalk shoveled, but is going to run commissioner and regulator of the cable commission. You have been a poor steward, Ms. Abrams, of your position, and this city council has been a poor steward of the Cable Commission, and you have abused it. Mr. Zick is right, because you don't want to hear commentary and information on localism and diversity of your poor management and many poor decision. You're going to shut down the cable station and let it go black. Poor, poor, poor. Ms. Longry, or Mr. Zick, on his TV show, has saved that big historic tree outside the shores. That tree should be named the Zick Tree. It's one of the most prominent and most beautiful trees in the city of Maplewood. And it wasn't saved because of the poor city management. It was saved because of Mr. Zick's cable TV show. Boy, Ms. Juniman leaves the city council meeting because she doesn't have time to listen to the public. Ms. Juniman tells the public here that people who are advocating and fighting for seniors on fixed incomes and others on low incomes, that they're insulting and disrespectful.
Mr. Berglund, you know the rules of civility are show respect during comments and discussions. You're being disrespectful, Mr. Berglund. Could you please be respectful?
Thank you, Mayor. Where I seen disrespect tonight is I seen when a council member sat up there and insulted the members of the public advocating for people who need a break, who can't have their property taxes jacked up, and yet she hides when her husband was, my understanding, fired from 3M, and she went to six or seven annual meetings and bitched and complained so he could get a big pension. And the people who don't have those kind of pensions raise their property taxes.
Adjourned. Thank you. We're done. Adjourn the meeting.
Wow. Nora Slawick has an anger management problem there. And of course, Kevin Berglund exposed her hypocrisy unbelievably well, as well as Kathleen Juniman, because Kathleen Juniman was up there telling the people of Maplewood that they got no right to come to her and complain about property taxes being increased. You know, and that she, you know, I mean, she acted like she was above it all, and that she was, you know, everybody's got to do their fair share for the city. Again, you know, the church, it's about the city church, Maplewood City, Maplewood Community Center Church, Maplewood City Council Church, where that is the end-all to everything. That is the be-all to everything. So if you complain about the church, the Maplewood City Council Church, you are to be excommunicated, and we will shut down the meeting. And that's what Mayor Slawick did. She shut down the meeting rather than wait for his 3 minutes to be done. And, of course, the effect of that was I didn't get to speak. Another guy didn't get to speak. Of course, you know, who cares? You know, but also the city council members didn't get to speak. They didn't get to finish their agenda. I mean, just short-sighted. They're so thin-skinned. And you hear them making comments while other people are speaking. Of course, Kathleen Juniman was gone. You know, and when Kevin Berglund was speaking, boy, she popped out of that back room and was starting to come around. You know, I did something. You're not going to see this on the video, but while I was there, it was visitor's presentation. I was going to speak next. So I just went up to the podium and started speaking. And of course, the mayor is all concerned that the audio is still on, and she goes, "Oh, in the control room, make sure the audio is off, and we're turned to black." Of course, they were right away. See, they don't want you to know what's going on in this city. They don't want their hypocrisy exposed, because in exposing their hypocrisy, they can't do their sweetheart deals to their favorite people while taking money from you, and who cares if you suffer for that? We're going to deal out our money to our special friends, and our special friends are those who go to the community center, our special friends are, we're going to do an economic development for and give them money just because they've been around a long time. So So Kathleen Juneman comes back after the, you know, right, just before it closes down, you know, seconds before it closes down. And so I go up to the podium. Kathleen Juneman walks to her seat. And then while I'm talking, walks back, comes up to right up to the microphone and says, when somebody talks about me, I take offense to that, some to that matter, and I'm going to respond, you know. And I, really? Yeah, you had to do that? I mean, Kevin Berglund was right, okay? Kathleen Juneman, you can't trivialize the people of Maplewood like you do, and then expect not to be come back and your the truth of how you live and how you behave to be exposed. Okay? The city council is not God. So that's, you know, that's why Kevin was very right, Mr. Berglund was very right in exposing the hypocrisy of the rules in the city of Maplewood. And Mayor Slawick to shut him down in exposing the hypocrisies. This is visitors' presentations. This is the St. Paul City Council, you know, saying that, you know, Trump's condemned candidate's speech. Well, we condemn your speech, Kathleen Juneman and Mayor Slawick. I condemn your speech. Just let it ride. You got 3 minutes. And if you wouldn't behave the way you do, you wouldn't get the responses you're getting. So either change the way you behave, thus we don't have to comment on how you behave. So don't do a EDA tax. We wouldn't have to talk about it. Don't do the Maplewood Community Center. We wouldn't have to go up there and tell about the $1 million losses that the poor people of the city of Maplewood and the senior citizens are having to be taxed and levied on them year after year after year because you can't manage your budget. And then Kevin brings up, oh, cable mismanagement. Now, you know, they can't run the ambulance fund. They can't run the garbage. That's operating at losses. And they're actually charging. They're actually collecting bills for the city of St. Paul, thousands of dollars of bills. In the Maplewood budget, you're paying for people living in St. Paul, Maplewood. Okay? And they can't run the Maplewood Community Center. And now they're going to run cable, which you won't see this show live anymore in Maplewood. Oh, by the way, go to youtube.com/speechlessmn and you can follow my shows. We'll still be talking about Maplewood. We'll still be going down to the Maplewood City Council. We'll still be talking. They think this will go away. It won't. So here's this cable, now Maplewood, now cable commissioners. They fortunately have left open. They have about 8 or 9 channels. So they're still going to have 15, 16, and some, you know, 6 to 7 more channels. But nothing will be played on them. Okay? They don't have the content. They're not ready for it. So this channel will go black unless they put on reruns time after time of shows they've done in the past that are so outdated, the reality of those shows are meaningless anymore. So you won't get that in Maplewood. But guess what? You're going to have to still pay the same price. They're just going to pay, if you're on Comcast, you're going to have to pay the $4.20. And now, here's the hypocrisy. Maplewood, who can't manage a business, can't put their, the only way they can put their city in a positive cash flow is by raising your taxes way above what they need to be. Boy, in you know, what was that, the North St. Paul City Council meeting? They have Maplewood as the second highest property tax city in Ramsey County, except for St. Paul. And White Bear Lake is, you know, Maplewood, $651 for an average home of $157,000. White Bear Lake is $265, let's say, around there. That's a, you know, almost a $400 difference. And Why is that? You know what? White Bear Lake doesn't have debt, zero debt, money in reserves. And Maplewood thinks, here's what Maplewood thinks is good fiscal management, and there's a reason we know this, okay? Because Maplewood says, wow, you got to have debt, you got to have deficits, you got to raise your taxes, the people's taxes. That's how you have good financial management, because that's what they do, okay? They don't make money at their enterprise funds in things that should be shipped out, done to the in the private industry. Instead, what they do is they come to the Cable Commission and say, oh, you got $4.5 million of reserves? Well, that's financial mismanagement. Maplewood City Manager and the attorney were here today crying to the commission here that, oh, we don't have an agreement, a termination agreement yet, and you guys have financially mismanaged this place, and we want our part of that $4.5 million. The only problem is in the contract, they're not entitled to it. If they want to terminate and separate, they're not entitled to that money. And of course, they have their opinion, the board has theirs, the franchisor has their opinion. But you see the mentality? If you have a surplus, you're mismanaging. And you should have spent it all. Okay? Where proper management is going into debt and having to raise taxes to meet your needs because you're messing up in your finances. I mean, you know, when I talk about on this show about depravity and human depravity, that's a full-on frontal assault of human depravity right there. That debt is the best thing you could do, and stretching your citizens' budget is the best thing you can do, and having a reserve is a terrible thing to do. So, the commission, wise management, raising money, making sure they have money in reserves to pay the bills and to buy new equipment and have the money there, and because things break down. Maplewood, we're on a thin margin, you know. We got to keep raising taxes. Just a real different philosophy. So who's the mismanager? And it was good Kevin Berglund talked about the tree in Maplewood, because it was a nice save that he did by pointing that out. And Maplewood was just going through a tree ordinance. And of course, Maplewood doesn't have to follow the ordinance, but other people do. All right, I'm just going to touch real briefly on the Grazzini-Rucki case, and it's coming up. Here's what you're not hearing. You will not hear in this case the bad decisions that Judge Timothy Warmanger made. You're not going to hear about the bad behavior of Judge David Knudsen. You won't hear about that, okay? You won't hear about the bad investigations that didn't, well, the investigations that didn't take place in Lakefield with the Lakefield Police Department. You're not going to hear about that. You're not going to hear about the 6 gunshots that was left on a voice message. You're not going to hear that the police did not even investigate it. Okay, you got a phone call that came in. All right, did they trace the phone call? No. And if they did, they're not telling anybody about it. And matter of fact, they're not telling anybody about it to such an extent that Judge David Knudsen, and the papers are reporting that these things were looked into and they were found not to be credible. Well, wait a second. There's a voicemail message of 6 gunshots, one for each of the kids and his wife, if it was him. So if it was him, then they know this man threatened all their lives. And he could have been very upset, you know. He could have been being defrauded and upset, and this is his way of handling it. Well, that doesn't work. But if it wasn't him, then who was it? Trace the phone call. Because find out who that person is, because was it Sandra Grazini-Ruckey's friend that did that? Or was it the dad? And if that's not credible evidence, if it was a father and that's not credible evidence that these kids were in danger and fear for their lives, therefore a reason to run, and therefore is a defense for anybody who hid the children, why isn't that being brought up? Why isn't that being talked about? Huge, huge, huge problem that's not being dealt with in this case. So I've had Sandra Grazini on this show a number of times. Another person of interest that's just been charged, Dee Dee Evavold, is also is a friend of mine and knows what's going wrong with the courts. I mean, she's pretty funny. An article came out in Newsweek, and she's quoted, you know, I guess I get to be one of the dumbest criminals out there because I left photographs on my phone of where the kids were. So, but she has a defense. I don't know if she's using it, but her defense is you can deprive a parent of custodial rights if there's abuse involved, and that's anybody. So we'll see what happens with that. Well, Maplewood, good night. Last lights out, last show in Maplewood live for the year and maybe forever. Who knows? But people, you need to speak up. Go to the YouTube channel, Speechless MN, and watch the show there. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Sets on fire.